Welcome, my friends, to this analysis that we're doing about the top 20 public companies in the world. And today we're going to look at Saudi Aramco. Saudi Aramco is very, very, it's a very large company. And it's interesting to understand that the origins of this company has a lot of geopolitical reasons. And also, it has to do with the fact that they are seated in one of the places where the largest oil reserves in the world are, which is the peninsula of Saudi Arabia. And the company is formed by two big presidents. One is the Sauds, that they became first expelled during the end of the 19th century, but by the start of the 20th century, they came back to regain their political power in Saudi Arabia. And by world wars, which impacted a lot the geopolitical sense of all this of this region, it's when Saudi Aramco emerges, but first as the organization of the exploitation of oil, because there were shortages during this World War One. And then this person, King Ibn Saud, who I'm telling you was the head of the family of the Saud, he was getting a lot of political power during the 1920s. And at some point, he provided the concessions to these companies, first the Bahrain Petroleum Company, and then there was these companies of Standard Oil from the Rockefellers that were trying to exploit, take advantage or produce oil in Arabia. And during 1930s, after the World War One, SoCal got involved and formed this company, California Arabian Standard Oil Company, in the 1933. And the government of Saudi Arabia granted a concession to SoCal in preference to Iraq Petroleum Company. And this concession allowed SoCal to explore for oil in Saudi Arabia. However, they tried to find, and during 4 years, they couldn't find any oil. So in 1936, the company had no success at locating oil, so then Texaco purchased 50% of the stake of the concession. And however, and then they still insisted. By 1938, they finally got success with the seventh drill site in Dharan in 1938, which was called the well Dammam number 7, and that's where they started producing around 1500 barrels per day. So that happened to be a lot of confidence to keep up with the project, no? So in 1944, so this is during the World War II, the company name was changed from California Arabian Standard Oil Company to Arabian American Oil, which is Aramco, no? And by 1948, Standard Oil of New Jersey, which later was known as Exxon, purchased 30%, and Saucony Vacuum, which was later Mobil, purchased 10% of the company. So SoCal and Texaco retained 30% each. So that's the 100%. This was an American company, no? So in 1949, Aramco did incursions into the Emirate of Abu Dhabi, leading to a border dispute between Abu Dhabi and Saudi Arabia. And in 1950, King Abdulaziz, he threatened to nationalize the country's oil facilities to pressure Aramco to agree to a share profit of 50-50. So in 1950, they completed the Trans-Arabian Pipeline, the TAP line, which is of 2,200 kilometers. It's the longest pipeline in the world. And after 2 years of exploration in the shallow Arabian Gulf waters, they discovered the Safaniya field in 1951, which proved to be the world's largest offshore oil field. So in 1962, the company reached a milestone, which was a cumulative crude oil production of nearly 5 billion barrels, which is 13 million barrels per day. So this company was already large, very, very large in the 1960s. No? However, in 1964, King Faisal of Saudi Arabia was appointed king, and during from 64 to 1975, so this is 10 years, King Faisal helped the company in their pursuit of production. So for instance, for 1971, shipments of crude oil and petroleum products from Ras Tanura Marine Terminal surpassed 1 billion barrels per year for the very first time. But during his tenure of King Faisal, the U.S. supported Israel during the Yom Kippur War. So that puts a lot of pressure, because then the Saudi Arabian government decided to acquire 25% of participation in Aramco. So by 1973, the government bought, increasing this interest to 60% by 1974. In 1975, King Faisal was assassinated, and then King Fahd became the first deputy prime minister. His brother was Khalid, was the king, the new crown prince, and he started to put together a plan for development with the Saudi government effort to achieve economic progress. However, with this plan, King Fahd became, well, he wasn't the king, he was a minister, he was deputy prime minister, but he became more and more involved in the decisions of the government, because King Khalid had heart troubles and he delegated much of his job to King Fahd, no? Well, to Fahd in that moment. In that moment, by 1974, I was telling you, they acquired interest of 60% of Aramco, and by 1980, the Saudi government increased its interest in Aramco by 100%. That's when, under this, under King Khalid, it's when Saudi government got the total control of Aramco. No? In 1982, then King Fahd started ruling over Saudi Arabia, because King Khalid passed away in 1982. And after assuming power, King Fahd continued the rapid development of the kingdom's infrastructure fueled by this oil boom that happened in the 70s decade, no? 1970s. So in 1988, the company Saudi Arabian Oil Company, so now it's going to be called Saudi Aramco, was officially established. And then in 1988, this is what happened, no? By 1990s, high quality oil and gas were discovered in three areas of the south of Riyadh. And in 1990, after the start of the Gulf War, Aramco was expected to replace much of the oil production removed from the global market due to the embargo of Iraq and occupied Kuwait. So this amounted to produce an extra 5 million barrels per day to keep the global oil market stable. In addition, Aramco was expected to provide all the coalition aviation and diesel needs. So this made the company a very, very valuable asset for the world, because it has a very large ability to expand production because of the very, very large reserves. And also it has a lot of economies of scale. So the production of them, the cost of production of barrel is very, very low compared to other oil companies. So as long as the oil prices are high, this company is a money machine. And when prices are low or experiencing slowdown, then this company suffers, since its business has to do with the commodity of oil, no? So in 1995, King Fahd suffered a stroke and put the royal family into a crisis. And by 1996, the company started to do overseas investment in Europe by purchasing the Greek company Motor Oil Hellas Corinth Refineries. And they started to build their infrastructure, getting research and development centers in 2000 in Daran. They also started to exploit their gas initiative in 2001. And in 2003, Royal Dutch Shell and Total SA formed a partnership with Saudi Aramco in Core Venture One, creating several joint ventures, Lukoil, Sinopec, and Repsol. By 2004, Aramco was producing 8.6 million barrels per day out of a potential of 10 million barrels per day. So in 2008, the crude oil prices were exceeding $130 a barrel, so they decided to produce an increase to 9.7 million barrels per day, making the price plummet in 2009 and then reducing the production by 7.7 millions of barrels per day. In 2013, crude oil production total was 3.4 billion barrels, and it managed over 100 oil and gas fields in Saudi Arabia, including 288 trillion standard cubic feet of natural gas reserves. By 2016, the Deputy Crown Prince of Saudi Arabia, Mohammed bin Salman, which is in this other slide, announced he was considering to list the shares of the company and selling around 5% of them to build a large sovereign wealth fund. And in 2019, the company became public and they commenced trading on the Tadawul Stock Exchange. So this company then got to a market capitalization of 1.8 trillion and surpassed the 2 trillion mark on the second day of trading. In 2020, it is one of the largest companies in the world by revenue. They have the second largest proven crude oil reserves of more than 270 billion barrels, and the largest daily oil production of oil producing companies, and the largest single hydrocarbon network, the Master Gas System. So in June 2020, because of the prices, they laid off nearly 500 of its more than 70,000 employees. And let's look at this slide that I like a lot, no? Let's consider that this is around 2020, when the price was with a lot of harm because of the pandemic of COVID-19. And right now the price is at $70. So the outlook of Saudi Aramco is totally, totally different right now that we're on December, that we are doing this evaluation. Look at this, total assets. We have only numbers by 2017, but they were around $300 billion and now they became $500 billion in 3 years. Property and equipment is also, they increased, no, from $200 billion to almost $330 billion. It's almost increased 52%. And the company increased very largely its debt, no? Because before it was $22 billion and now it became $144 billion. They were doing this big bet that probably the oil will become more and more expensive. Here's what I'm putting like as an analysis, no? Before, at the $56 of price per barrel, which was the average, I made an adjustment to $2,021 purchase power, and they used to produce around 14 million of barrels per day equivalent, no? And the net profit per barrel, if they sold it at $56 per barrel, now it was, they were getting 15%, no? But see how if the price drops to $44, we get a net profit per barrel of $9, which is what I'm trying to explain, no? Total revenues, see how this company is impacted, no? Total revenues in 2017 was $281 billion, and then they decreased because of this drop of 22% of the price, no, in these 3 years. However, I think that by 2021, the outlook is going to be totally different. Still, with $44 per barrel, the company is profitable. See, for $232 billion of sales, they get a net income of $50 billion. But now that the price per barrel is almost double, it would be very interesting to see what is going to be the net income for 2021. So this is part of the problems that these companies have, that they don't, well, we can say that this company actually may influences the price, because although this is a private company, in the sense that you can invest in it, it's actually a state company of the Saudi Arabian government, no? So if they have political arrangements with other countries and other producers, they can impact the price through the OPEC, no? The company produces cash flow from operations of more than $50 billion. So in 2020, it was $76 billion. In 2017, it was around $100 billion of cash flow from operations. It is going to be very interesting how this company evolves, as the in Mexico, politicians say that people don't use oil anymore, but I don't think that's the case. I don't think that these large companies think the same, although they are doing a lot of investment in research and development to understand better their reserves. And I believe also that the gas and many of the products that they produce, which is also very integrated, this company, it's not crude oil only, but they provide very, very large of the consumption of Asia of energy. That's what makes them very, very wealthy and very, very needed, no? So thank you for taking your time to hear us. And here is this slide with our contact information. If you want to know more about investments, send us a message. I'll be very happy to hear from you. And I hope you enjoyed this video. Have a great day.